Good evening. Today we will talk about the carcinoma of the gallbladder. When I was a student, this was supposed to be a very dreaded disease, which has a longevity of hardly months. Now, the investigation and staging has improved to a lot. The surgical management and post-operative chemotherapy and radiotherapy has gone beyond that. It is well within our reach compared to other malignancies. Even then, this is one of the dreaded malignancies which has got a very short 5-year survival. When I was a student, a lot of work had been going on in North, because this was specifically more in North India, especially SGPGI. Lucknow, they have done a lot of work on that, like radiation for pain relief, multi-organ resection, chemotherapy. Everything, they have even started preoperative chemotherapy for the patients, but till now it is only in the clinical trial level. That is a new adjuvant therapy for carcinoma of the gallbladder, still at the clinical trial level, has not come out with a definitive program. The length of the gallbladder is about 7 to 10 centimeter average. It can hold a capacity of 30 to 50 ml. Divided into body, fundus, infundibulum, neck and the cystic duct, that becomes the infundibulum, then the neck, then it becomes a cystic duct. Usually it drains into the common hepatic duct, then the common hepatic duct becomes the common bile duct. That is normal, but it has got a lot of variation that we need not worry about now. The lymphatic drainage is the cystic node, the triangle of Calitz, or the node just along the freeboard of the lesser omentum nearer the CBD. You can see a lot of nodes in between the CBD and the portal vein, and you also get retroduodenal veins. Once you cauterize it, you will get it. After this, these are the draining nodes. More than this, it becomes a distant metastasis. The fifth most common neoplasm, 3 per 1 lakh, most common in North India, that's 22 in 1 million population. Chile and South America is again common. If you're diagnosing it to the extent of 50%, it is resectable. The overall 5-year survival, again you can see, less than 5 months. The first lady whom I operated way back in 1989, the carcinoma of the gallbladder, she hardly lived for 2 months. She passed away. Incidence hit up about 0.2 to 3% in all cholecystectomies. It's about 1 to 2% in all lap coles. Women are 2 to 3 times more affected than men. Risk factors, anything which irritates the gallbladder, it can be due to salmonella. A patient who has got salmonella in the form of HR, high O titer. But if you could culture the bile and see gallbladder, it is a pre-malignant condition. You will have to remove the gallbladder. Helicobacter bilis, primary sclerosis in cholangitis, anomalous pancreatica biliary junction, where the bile is regurgitating the pancreatic juice and the bile gets mixed and it regurgitates and causes irritation, activated bile, then it goes into malignancy. Then comes cholelithiasis, that is more than 3 centimeter. It can irritate, cause metaplasia, then malignancy can come. Other risk factors are the porcelain gallbladder, where there is calcification of the gallbladder wall. A solitary polyp is always dangerous. You'll have to observe it clearly. Multiple polyps can be due to cholestasis of the gallbladder, that you need not worry. A solitary, more than 0.5 centimeter or 1 centimeter growing. If it is a pedunculated polyp, suddenly the movement of the ciliated movement in the bile in push and changes stops, that means it is going for malignancy. Whenever you get a solid polyp of 1 centimeter, you go ahead, take it as a risk. And then go ahead with the cholecystectomy. The other one is a choledochal cyst. any cyst, a polydactyl cyst, either intrahepatic or extrahepatic, is prone for malignancy. You can say that I will excise it, then the malignancy will be no. The same type of pathology will be inside the bile duct in the liver, biliary radicals, and you will get a recurrence of the disease. A removal of the colidocal cyst is not making the patient immune against developing a bile duct malignancy. Pathology, 60% occurs in the fundus, 30% in the body, 10% is in the neck. If it's lucky, it comes in the neck so that the patient will come with acute cholecystitis. The bad duct is it can easily infiltrate into the cystic duct, nearby bile duct, make it as locally invasive tumor, then we'll have to, the prognosis comes down. Fundus is the best. Morphological types, it can be an infiltrative, nodular, combined nodular infiltrative papillary. The papillary has got a better prognosis. This is a combination of both nodular and infiltrative. This has got a borderline prognosis. Histological types, 90% of them are adenocarcinomas. Squamous adeno is 4, neuroendocrine 3, sarcoma 1.6, unspecified is 1.1, melanoma less than 1. Three common clinical scenarios identified after getting a histopathological report following a routine cholecystectomy. Discovered intraoperatively, there is a suspicion that this may be a malignancy, or suspected before surgery. It is better you suspect before surgery, but majority of times it may not be possible except some definite or investigative findings are there. It's rather difficult to diagnose early, but as you get experience, see more number of cases. If you work in a hepatobiliary pancreatic unit, you'll be able to make out the malignancy preoperatively itself. That is by seeing cases regularly. Clinical presentation, a right upper quadrant pain, usually not a good sign. But if it is due to only a distended gallbladder due to an obstructive lesion at the neck of the gallbladder, the whole thing may be due to an empyema of the gallbladder, weight loss, anorexia, jaundice, palpable mass. These are the signs of advanced disease. Rarely it presents acute cholecystitis. Palpable mass is clearly an ominous finding, a predicts high rate of irresectability and advanced disease. Jaundice is represented by locally advanced disease, probably it is encroaching on the cystic duct and cystic duct commonly called a duct junction or a lymph node near the cystic duct along the border of the lesser omentum is obstructing the duct, which is in favor of a locally advanced disease. Investigation and management. Investigations are ultrasound abdomen, a triphasic multi-slice CT, MRA with MRA or MRCP, PET CT to find out the stage of the disease if there is a localized invasion. Staging laparoscopy helps you. CA99 serum is a good marker when the other findings are corroborative and blood investigations. You get anemia, hypoalbuminemia, leukocytosis is non-specific. Elevated alkaline phosphatase is only there is an obstruction to the biliary tree. It can be due to anything. A raised bilirubin again is non-specific to the disease. It can occur in so many other conditions. First, these two must give you an idea that it could be an obstruction to the CBD. Due to what, we do not know. Ultrasonogram, discontinuous thickening of the gallbladder mucosa, very, very important. Patchy discontinuity of the mucosa of the gallbladder is very highly suggestive of gallbladder malignancy. Diffuse thickening of the gallbladder wall more than 1 centimeter is again, you must have a suspicion. Heterogeneous mass, this is very important. There is areas of hyperdensity and hyperechoic and hypoechoic. Heterogeneous mass replacing the GB is another suspicion for malignancy. Neural calcifications, again, that gives that it could be a pre-malignant condition turning into malignancy, something like a porcelain gallbladder, mass protruding into the lumen, not moving well, solitary, then again it is in favor. And if it is near the gallbladder bed, there is a lot of interface between the liver and gallbladder. That says there is something infiltrating into the bed of the gallbladder. CT for complete staging, evaluation of the region nodes, diagnosis of the extrahepatic disease, more anatomic information than the ultrasound. Features suggestive of carcinoma gallbladder are, it's a heterogeneous mass. Some areas will be taking the contrast, some areas will not be taking. A differential intake in the same mass is highly suggestive of gallbladder malignancy. When there is a uniform gallbladder, and there is one area of focal or there is a diffuse wall thickening, you must think of gallbladder malignancy. Heterogeneity, hence enhancing discrete intraluminal mass. Sometimes everything will be enhanced properly. One thing alone will different enhancement and it will be intraluminal. That is in favor of malignancy. Discontinuous thickening of the gallbladder mucosa. You can nicely see when it is nicely outlined. You can see patchy ulcerations or in favor of malignancy. So CD, you can see there is a stone, there is an hypoechic area. This is most likely a gallbladder malignancy for the liver that is extending here. Again, if you carefully say there is a differential enhancement with a muscle effect at the infundibulum of the gallbladder and neck with distension of the gallbladder due to an obstruction here. MRI sensitive is 70 to 100% of the hepatic invasion. 60 to 75 of the lymph nodal metastasis can be made out. It does not change the preoperative imaging that has been caught by a CT. So either one is good, depends on one's own experience and acquaintance with the investigative modality. The person who is well versed with CT will be able to interpret better. The person well versed with MRI will be interpret MRI better. That is how it goes. That one does not replace the other in this. But this is for occult metastasis. You can see the omental and peritoneal deposits. Sensitivity is about 57 to 86. So when do you do a PET CT? When you are condemning a patient for any other procedure, when you are able to make out a locally advanced disease which is not resectable due to a vascular invasion, then or it is extending on to the other lobe or affecting the confluence because of the extension, then you condemn that patient for anything. Before condemning the patient to give chemotherapy, you would like to know whether there is a cut primary anywhere, a cut peritoneal deposits or this thing, where the PET scan is useful. That will give you the complete staging of the disease. Tumor marker CA99 more than 37 unit per ml is significant. When this CA99 has got a knack of increasing in all the cases of obstructive jaundice, either due to a periapillary growth, CA adduct pancreas, and so on and so forth. But this CA99 must be correlated with the rest of the finding, including the clinical finding where the patient says there is a loss of weight and loss of appetite. The blood investigation says the patient is having anemia. The liver function says there is an increase in ALP and bilirubin level. And your CT and ultrasound says a differential enhancement in heterogeneity. Then you come to a reasonable conclusion that it could be a malignancy of the gallbladder. May prove useful in combination. Combine this thing, reasonable cost effective approach. This is what I have said to you now. Preoperative diagnosis, not at all mandatory in carcinoma of the gallbladder. If you have got a doubt, you put in a scope, you see there is a doubt that's a malignancy, open it immediately, don't try to go on. Or if you've got a reasonable preoperative doubt, it could be a malignancy, don't attempt a laparoscopy at all. Go with the mind of doing either a radical or an extended cholecystectomy. Okay, not mandatory, indicated for inoperable, unresectable, where you want to give and neoadjuvant chemotherapy still at the clinical level. The only palliation in an inoperable case, what we have to do is prevent the patient from itching by draining 30% of the biliary tree, either in the form of a PTBD, percutaneous transhepatic biliary drainage, or in the form of a stent if it is possible, or in the form of a segment 3 bypass. If you have opened and it becomes inoperable over the table, segment 3 is always spared. You can drain the segment 3, and if there is a suspicion of ongoing gastric outlet obstruction, the same time we can do a gastrojejunostomy. That I will subsequently show you. This is the treatment for an unresectable tumor. Bile cytology is unwarranted. Sensitivity is 75%. We don't do it at all. TNM staging, TX cannot be assessed. No evidence of zero, the tumor is T0, TIS is carcinoma in situ, invades lamina propria, the muscular layer, T1A lamina propria, T1B is muscular layer, T2A, the connective tissue on the peritoneal side, T2B is the gallbladder bed, T3, it perforates the serosa, or direct invasion of the liver into the gallbladder bed, or direct involvement of the stomach, duodenum, or colon. Momentum or pancreas extrahepatic, all these are resectable. That is why it comes in the T3, even though the prognosis is not good. T4 involves the main portal vein of the hepatic artery. In which two or more have the extrahepatic organ, including all that. T4 is not a disease for resectability. NX is N, there is no lymph node. N0 is there is no regional. 1 to 3 is N1. More than 4 regional lymph nodes are N2. SSS, no distant metastasis, distant metastasis. Usually occurs in the lungs and bones. Staging prognostication, stage and prognosis, stage 0, 60% survival rate, 139%, 215%, 35%, 4 is 1%. You can see how the stage brings down, every stage is bringing down the survivability by 1/3 or half. So that is why you must catch it early. Polyps, single polyp, more than 50, increasing in size. One more thing which is to be added here is, if it's a pedunculated polyp, if it is nicely showing a movement in the various position of the patient doing ultrasonogram, the next ultrasound it becomes stiff. It is not moving here and there, the tip. Then you must suspect it is becoming malignant. Then straight away go ahead with the cholecystectomy. That is for polyps less than 1 centimeter. If it's 1 centimeter, straight away go and do a cholecystectomy, send it for the frozen biopsy, wait if it becomes malignant, a complete the radical cholecystectomy. Management modalities available, staging laparoscopy. Why staging laparoscopy? If it's inoperable, it is stuck to many of the structures, the general condition of the patient is not good, and you are not going to do a major resection. Or if there are extensive deposits in the peritoneum with ascites or metastasis in the liver, you stop there. Some people have got a knack of, when everything is all right, they'll have to seek for the aortocaval nodes. If the aortocaval node is positive, it's a stage 4 disease, you don't operate. The same holds good even for pancreatic head malignancy. If there's an aortocaval node positive, theoretically speaking, you should not do surgery. Laparotomy, intracaval, this thing, cholecystectomy, simple or radical, multivisceral resection. This I am coming. You have done cases where you have done a radical cholecystectomy with a Buccal's because it was infiltrating the CVD, but the prognosis is very bad. You can dispense in part of the stomach, you can dispense in part of the colon. All these are possible. So, multivisceral resection have been advocated long back in 1996 by the LGPDI. Now it has come very much handy and still you can do, but the prognosis and the longevity is not much. Then CVD excision, again it tells that there is a local invasion, but you can excise the CVD. If you are lucky, you get a free thin CVD just above the duodenum. Cut it there, excise the whole CVD, go to the bifurcation or just 1 centimeter below and do an hepatic duodenostomy. Again, prognosis is bad. or zero resection is not attained in many of the cases. Local recurrence is more. A major appendectomy, only one vein or the artery is involved, or if the ductal thing is extending onto the one of the ducts, then you can do a major appendectomy either in the form of the right or left, commonly being the right appendectomy, and adjuvant therapy subsequent to a resection for any other malignancy. Prevent unnecessary surgical exploration. See, there are multiple deposits in the CCCCC. This is a hopeless case. And if you carefully, there is a mild cirrhotic liver. So this becomes irresectable. The only thing is, if you have got a good interventionist, to prevent the pruritus, you will have to put a PTBD and be done with it. If it is negotiable, put a stent via the endoscopic route and change the stent once in a way. You can even put a self-expanding metallic stent. Laparoscopy, you can increase the staging by doing a laparoscopic ultrasound. Inter-aortic cava nodes, this requires a little dissection. Only when you are familiar how to do it, you do it. Send it for a frozen section. Once it becomes positive, I tell you, complete resection with negative margin with only crotty, that is called radical or extended cholecystectomy. We remove the gallbladder. We don't do anything with the CVD. We divide the cystic duct, take segment 5, which forms the bed of the gallbladder, and also 4B, which is very adjacent, and there's a connectivity. So a radical cholecystectomy means a cholecystectomy with removing all the fibrofatty tissues, plus or minus. Some people do it, some people do not do it. But along with the lymph nodes, you do segment 5 and 4B resection. That's all. The patient do well. Radical or extended is recommended for T1B, T2, and T3. With sometimes localized hepatic invasion, since we are taking a 5 and 4B, this will be all right. There's a limited regional lobe involvement. These are the cases we do. Optimal resection consists of cholecystectomy, limited hepatic resection, typically segment 4B and 5, and portal lymphadenectomy is nothing but along the free border of the lesser omentum up to supraduodenal portion. Sometimes you can even mobilize Cochrane and take the retroduodenal nodes also. So this is what we have done in our unit, a radical cholecystectomy. And extended liver resection is to ensure major resection approximately. Extended liver resection is nothing but 1 to 2 centimeters all around. You don't take 5 and 4B. Segment 5, 4B and 5 resection, this is what we completely resect. 5 is gone, 4B is gone. And here, we don't do anything. We remove the whole thing and we will leave it. This is the portal bifurcation. Now we are turning the liver and showing you the left lobe is here, the right lobe is here. Major hepatic resection segment 4B and 5 becomes major, but is to achieve R0 resection, except especially tumor invading the right portal pedicle. Tumor in the lower end of the gallbladder neck encroaches on the protohepatic, but increasing morbidity and mortality, don't do it. The classical thing is involvement of the right portal pedicle. You can go ahead straight away with the right hepatectomy. The question is, will you remove the caudate lobe or not? We will remove the caudate lobe. This is the lymph node dissection. This is the cystic lymph nodes. This is the nodes along the CBD. That's pericoridocal lymph nodes. A retroperitoneal nodes. This is along the after cauterizing, this is along the port vein, you have to remove it. That's what it is. Superior mesenteric nodes and all, we don't remove it. Some people do it. Minimum of 6 lymph nodes should be removed for accurate staging. Regional lymph node, removal of nodes in the protohepatic, gastrohepatic ligament, and retroduodenal space only, not mesenteric nodes. Clear it. Take it in mind. Even though it's shown in the diagram, just to show you, but up to this it is resectable. Beyond that, it is irresectable. Oncologically, not a good dissection. Suspicious of aorta cavernosa, retropancreatic celiac lymph nodes. Suspicious nodes are sent for frozen. Frozen positive, terminate the procedure. At that time, what will you do? If you have opened and you have done this, you do a diversion in the form of a segment 3 bypass. If this is encroaching onto the duodenum, do a GJ to prevent a future gastric outlet obstruction. But then the performance status of the patient should be good. You should have an enough longevity and you have opened and then it becomes inoperable. This is the case where we have done a distal stomach, duodenum, colon, and liver bits. This we have taken along with the distal stomach. This is called multi-zero, multi-visceral dissection. Only if R0 can be achieved. Pancreatic or duodenum cleaver for extensive lymph node removal is not justified. Just for the sake of removing the lymph node, if you do a pancreatic or duodenectomy, it is not at all advisable oncologically in a case of CA double bladder. This is only for a contagious infiltration from the gallbladder to the head of the thing or infiltration of the CVD causing an obstructive jaundice. You can go along with this a pancreatic or duodenectomy. But morbidity high, mortality in experience that will not be there, but the survival, you cannot assure the patient that you will give a good survival. CBD excision indicated malignant invasion of the bile duct with jaundice, but one must consider the overwhelming poor prognosis because many of the resections are not all zero because of the continuity and contiguity of a lot of fibrous tissue in and around that area. That is why a CBD excision, again, like an excision of the pancreas, that is, tubercles along with excision of the radical excision of the gallbladder, both are not good prognostic because you are doing an extensive surgery, but you may not reach the R0. Because when you are doing a vocal, you are likely to have nodes along the intra-aortic cavernous area. In a hurry, you want to do surgery, you do surgery because you know how to do surgery, but it's not oncologically correct. Role of CD not justified. Routine CBD excision, no impact on survival, increases the morbidity, not associated with the high lymph node lead again and again and again. Until and when there is a direct infiltration by the tumor onto the CBD or a node that becomes infiltrative into the CBD causing an obstruction, don't do anything. Portal metastasis. See, some of the people operate, they spill the bile. They do not know there is a malignancy. So, some of the people get a malignance from cells from there, get into the port, they become portal malignant. So, what are the things you will do? You will have to do a slow desuffolation. Suddenly, the whole thing is not coming. Something like a chimney effect, even though it's not yet agreed, the chimney effect is definitely there. Extraction to be done in an endo bag whenever you feel there is a suspicion of malignancy. Even otherwise, if you learn how to release it with an endo bag without a hurry, you are doing good to the patient. Bile spill has to be prevented. The moment you do a bile spill, and subsequently the biopsy specimen comes as positive for malignancy, then there is no other thing. You have gone beyond and made it as a stage 4 disease. You have to give only a palliative thing. If you have not spilled the bile, but subsequently the biopsy comes as malignancy, you can go in and remove 1 or 2 centimeters of the liver in the margin and take free all the fibrofatty tissue along the CVD, remove the lymph nodes in the regional area only and come out. That may give you an equal result. But the moment you're spilled by, you're finished. Incident, the gallbladder is made for the first time on the histology. You set it, the biopsy comes as malignancy. This is examination after simple cholecystectomy for gallstone disease. So do it after that the biopsy comes. What will you do? T1A, proceed to simple cholecystectomy. ask the pathologist to say what is the T4 disease, T disease. If they say T1A, proceed to simple lymphadenopathy. If it is T1B, T2, T3, proceed to extended and radical cholecystectomy. This will give you a prognosis because you are going to do an RGL resection. Also, you will remove the regional lymph nodes. But the whole thing is becoming effective if you do not spill the bile only. If you spill the bile, that's a gone case. CAGB with jaundice, preoperative blood drainage to be done, the way lobe to be preserved, that is PTBD or ERC sending. Functional liver remnant is not adequate, extended right hepatectomy. Bring down the serum bilirubin to less than 3. You can do a portal embolization if it's not adequate. If the functional liver in the FLR is not adequate, you do a portal vein embolization so that the rest of the liver gets hypertrophy. Then you do an extended right hepatectomy because you will have to do 5, 6, 7, 8, and also 4. But some people have got a knack of doing a central hepatectomy, leaving 6 and 7. If it is not involving investigation-wise, they remove 4, 5, and 8 only. That is called central hepatectomy. But the prognosis is very, very poor. One of the Korean surgeons way back in 1997 when I attended, for such cases he used to do an in vitro resection of the tumor. Again, he re-implanted the tumor. But people have shouted at him like anything. So that in vitro excision of the tumor is no longer being done. He takes out the liver, do a brain surgery, again re-implant it. But it's not accepted. But in his hands, the results are good. The Korean surgeon. Role of adjuvant therapy, R1, R0, T3, N+, histological features, bile spill, don't spill. I also used to spill because I'm in a hurry to remove the gallbladder, but don't spill. This gemcitabine-based combination chemotherapy, Gemox, is the line of management. Role of adjuvant therapy, neoadjuvant. It is only a clinical trial. Like any other malignancy, the neoadjuvant is coming in a bigger way. Neoadjuvant has come for stomach. Neoadjuvant has come for many other things. But it has got an established entry into the esophagus, colon, rectum, and also borderline malignancy of the pancreas. Now slowly it is entering, its extending its tentacles into all this. Slowly you will get it because these fellows have to survive. Nah? The medical gastroenterologists, they will find out something or other that they will come. Palliative management, what are you going to palliate? There are two things to be palliated. One is the jaundice. Because of the jaundice, the patient has got severe pruritus. Day in and day out, he will have itching. Sometimes itch to an extent, they will ulcerate the areas. So, if you remove that itch, you'll think you've got. So, one is to palliate the obstructive delivery. What is the other thing? He is likely to go in for a gastric outlet obstruction. The third thing, of course, is pain control, which is not in your hand. You can try various techniques, celiac axis loss, there's that. And people, there is one study, if you go through the papers in 1997 published by Lucknow, SGPGI, they have clearly said irradiation to the local area palliates pain. You can see that. Okay, endoscopic. By stenting, PTBD, by an interventionist. I am fond of segment 3 bypass. You are the age group of segment 3 bypass people because this lasts longer. This gives, there is no stent, there is no external biliary drainage. One more thing, you are making the bile go into the enteric road by which the nutrition is better maintained. So every surgeon, whether it's a general surgeon or a surgical gastroenterologist, must be familiar with the segment 3 bypass. You must know how to approach segment 3. There are two ways. One is by the falciform ligament route to trace the ligamentum teres. End route, you see to that you don't injure the recurvating branches to the segment 4B. Then follow that. There will be an obliterated or unobliterated left umbilical vein, which was present in the infancy. If you trace that, it will go on, end as a fibrotic tissue or enter into the lumen of the left portal vein, clean the area there. Superior posterior is the third segment. From there, you can divide and divide, come up to the porta. You will get a long duct. Do a side to side, segment 3, jejunal anastomosis. Always in the intrahepatic anatomy, the bile duct is posterior superior to the portal vein. And nutritional support, pain control is only by radiation or very many invasive techniques. Relief of GOO. While you're opening, it becomes inoperable. You're doing a segmentary bypass. You think that may obstruct the outlet. Then you do a GJ also. Rest of the life with the palliative management, you live comfortably, you'll eat his food. Thank you.